Who is the best option at center in round one for the Dallas Cowboys? All that and more in this episode of the Locked On Cowboys podcast.
You are Locked On Cowboys, your daily Dallas Cowboys podcast. Part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day.
Locked On Cowboys. Welcome back to the Locked On Cowboys podcast, part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day. We'd like to thank you for making us your first listen of the day. Today's episode is brought to you by FanDuel. Make every moment more. Right now, new customers can get $150 in bonus bets guaranteed. That's $150, win or lose. Just visit FanDuel.com/LockedOn to get started. I am your host, Marcus Mosier. You can follow me on Twitter at Marcus_Mosier. Joining me today, as always, is Landon McCool. You can check him out on Twitter at McCoolBCB. And we've got a very, very special guest today. It's Voch Lombardi. Follow him on Twitter at Voch Lombardi. Two-time guest of the Locked On Cowboys.
That's right.
Check his channel out on YouTube. He has some fantastic shows up there right now with David Hellman. Brian Broaddus was just on the show. Voch, how you doing, buddy?
Hey, man, appreciate y'all, man. Thanks for having me. I just listen to y'all every day. So, you know what I'm saying? Appreciate y'all for being here. This is a match made in heaven. So we're at two, but this should be 3, 4, 5, and 6.
Yeah, this is going to be a series. The beginning of a beautiful friendship. And believe us, this is a two-way street. We listen to the show all the time. So we're
appreciate you.
All right, so Voch, we're 2 weeks out to the NFL draft, and it seems like the Cowboys are going to draft an offensive lineman in round one. So we're going to spend a lot of today's show discussing the offensive line. I want to start at center because there's a really interesting battle happening on Cowboys Twitter between Graham Barton, Zach Frazier, and Jackson Powers Johnson. Of those three, who is your favorite for the Cowboys?
Well, it depends on where you have Barton, because I just look at Barton as a dude that can play guard and center. So I think, and it's going to sound a little funny, but Barton is the best lineman out of all of them, right? I think he's the best offensive lineman. But I just believe in dudes that do it a lot, that have black belts in it. That's just something that I just call it, right? They got black belts in the position. You can see Jackson Powers Johnson has a black belt in center. You see that Zach Frazier has a black belt at center. So if we're just picking the best offensive lineman, it'll make sense, right, to take Graham Barton and just put him at center. So he's kind of technically my center number one, right? But I love Jackson Powers. Y'all just see me politicking and riding the fence right now. And I like what Jackson Powers Johnson is doing, right? But just the more I think about it, I had a conversation with Duke Mannyweather, and he made a lot of great points about Zach Frazier. And that's not a reason for me to change my mind or anything like that. You know, just, hey, you know, y'all trust your eyes, watch your film, do your own research. So if it's up to me, I'm going to stick with Graham Barton. But it's something special about Zach Frazier when you go back and watch his 2022 Texas tape, right? It's some dudes on that D-line, man. Mm-hmm. There are four pros on that D-line, and he handles them, he deals with them, he makes these top-tier blocks, pro-level blocks as a college dude. So you know that when he gets to the league, he's already going to be ready for that. And later on in this conversation, we're going to have a conversation about the dudes that are ready made, that do it right now, versus the dudes that we project that could possibly do it one day if they put in work. We'll have that conversation later. But I'm picking Graham Barton because I think he's the better dude. But if we're just looking at dudes that play center, that do center the best, maybe I'm picking Jackson Powers Johnson. But to not be phony, I'll say Barton.
Hey, Lane, I want to ask you, because you were on JPJ pretty early in this process. Are you still JPJ over Barton?
Yeah, I mean, I think they're dead tied, right? Like I think for me, it's just I've seen a little bit more of Jackson Powers Johnson playing center, and I think that kind of gives me a little bit more confidence. But the fact that you know, obviously Barton can play almost all five spots. He played center his freshman year, if I remember, if it's freshman year correctly. Mm-hmm. He clearly has the ability. I think if anything, now my question, and this is actually what I was going to ask Voch, was, what do you think about JPJ playing a position other than center? Like, do you feel like he has flexibility to kick out at guard? And if he does, do you feel like that he loses some of what makes him special as a center? Or does he become a little bit more routine as a guard? The aspects, the size, the strength, the recovery ability, does that become more routine when kicked out to guard, even though that's what makes him special at center?
So just to, you know, just let the audience know, right? Guards are not bad tackles and centers are not bad guards, right? All three of those dudes, they all do different things, right? And I just believe that if you have a black belt in something and you are special at something, I think you should play that even if you can play something else, okay? Mm. So Tyler Smith can play left tackle, but boy, he got a black belt at left guard, so I just want to leave him there. So Jackson Powers Johnson, being able to sit down over dudes lined up directly over you is tough. It's difficult. We, as Cowboy fans, we have had to deal with Biadasz for the last couple of years or whatever, and look, he's done some great things at center. Shouts out to him, but when he deals with the dudes, with these DJ Reader dudes, with the Washington Football Wizard kids, Dexter Lawrence, if they line up directly over you, it is a problem. And like you said, Jackson Powers Johnson just has this knack. And this is a black belt center trait. Snap the ball, offhand, anchor, recover, and just deal with humongous dudes lined up over him. And I think that is special. Now, if it's an emergency and you got multiple centers on your offensive line, I'm like, all right, cool, you can play guard. Eagles, right? Landon Dickerson can play center. Cam Jurgens can play center. Cool. One of y'all play guard. Sure. If Jackson Powers has to play guard because you got five centers on your offensive line, sure, he can do it. But I think he has a black belt at center, and I just want to leave black belts where they are. So he can, but I'm leaving him at center.
So Mel Kiper always preaches that you should draft based on your division. And that's a really good point that you bring up, Voch, about like the other defensive linemen in this division, because you have Dexter Lawrence, Jonathan Allen, Deron Payne, Jalen Carter, Jordan Davis. Like, I feel like this team really needs a center that can anchor well, right? And they can hold up one-on-one against some of these good defensive tackles. And for me, I think it is JPJ, even though I like Barton a little bit better as the prospect. What do you think?
Well, okay, so look, this is, and look, shouts out to Mel Kiper, man. Shouts out to what he does. But I think it's more so about conference and who you have at quarterback, right? So, yeah, we got the, you know, Washington kids, the Giants kids, the Eagles kids, but we're going to have to run into the Lions at some point. We're going to have to run into San Francisco at some point. McNeil is a gangster. Hargrave is a gangster. Mm-hmm. So now we have to parlay that with our quarterback and who our quarterback really is. I've seen Dak Prescott deal with Chuma Doga not knowing the plays. Him dealing with Cam Irvin and Cam Fleming, I've seen him deal with all the nonsense on the outside. If you go to the first Eagles game last year, Terrence Steele died a horrible death, and he should have gave up 12 sacks, but he only gave up what, two, three, something like that? Because Dak Prescott being able to step up and move around and shimmy and wiggle, that's what he's really good at. Now, when Tyler gets whooped, it ain't nothing Dak can do about it, because his pressure comes from A-gap. He's getting smoked. Run game also, right? When you think run game, the two things you got to do to block in the zone or just to block duos, you got to deal with A-gap and block the mic. So if I can put somebody top tier, whether it's center or whether it's tackle or whatever, I'm choosing center also, because I know that Dak can deal with the outsides. I know he's not that good in the middle. And shouts out to Duke Mandeweb. He was on my show a little bit. Y'all said that earlier. But
look at the name dropping. Look at the dude. Looks so good.
It's almost like he's good at this. Yeah.
No. But he said on my show, the one thing you would love to have is if you take a young center and put him in between Zach Martin and Tyler Smith. That makes a lot of sense. The one thing you don't want to do is put Tyler at tackle. You just got two youngsters next to each other, right? So I believe in building the middle. The middle is where it matters, because hey man, Javon Hargrave gonna whoop you if you don't fix it. You know what I'm saying? McNeil's gonna whoop you. DJ Reader, who plays for the Lions now, is gonna whoop you. You know what I'm saying? So yeah, give me the center. Give me Jackson Powers Johnson at center, or Graham Barton at center, or Zach Frazier at center, whatever works.
And real quick, just to point it out, like, I think to your point, it's a lot easier to scheme help for the tackle than it is to scheme help in the A gaps if something happens there. So
yes,
I think that makes a ton of sense to kind of attack it that way.
All right, I want to talk about the offensive tackles, because as much as we like the centers in this class, it seems like the Cowboys are hunting offensive tackle at least in rounds one or two, probably more likely round one. We will get to that next. This episode is brought to you by FanDuel. It's playoff time in the NBA and the NHL. We've got baseball in full swing. The Masters start today, and FanDuel is your place to bet on every game. Right now, new customers can get $150 in bonus bets guaranteed. That's $150, win or lose. Bet on everything from slap shots to home runs to slam dunks, all in an app that is safe, secure, and super easy to use. What are you waiting for? Visit FanDuel.com/lockedon and make your first bet an automatic win with FanDuel, America's number one sportsbook. Welcome back to the Locked On Cowboys podcast. Are you watching ESPN on your TV all day? Are you having to turn down the volume because of all that shouting? Make the switch to Locked On Sports today, a free 24/7 sports streaming channel programmed for you every day to bring you the biggest stories without all that screaming. Locked On Sports today brings you can't miss analysis, opinions, and news streaming 24/7 on YouTube or on the free Amazon Fire TV channels app, part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day. We are here with Voch Lombardi talking offensive line prospects for the Dallas Cowboys. And Voch, I got to get your thoughts on Tyler Guyton, because Landon and I discussed this yesterday. It seems like Tyler Guyton has been the most mocked player to the Cowboys in round one. Mm-hmm. What are your thoughts on him?
So here's my thing about Tyler Guyton, right? Rather just players that are rough around the edges, right? Because there's raw players and there's rough around the edges. I think Tyler Guyton's rough around the edges, okay? Mm-hmm. There's nothing wrong with being a player that's rough around the edges. But one thing I want to look for, two things really, is how you win and are you winning with some type of control, right? Control as an offensive lineman means so, and just as anything, right? Like if you're watching Liatu Latu, he wins with control. If you're watching Byron Murphy, he wins with control. If you're Caleb Williams, even if he's under the rest, he throws under control, even when it's looking funny, right? When I look at, let's just say, you know, Mims from Georgia, he's a rough around the edges player, but I've seen him whoop people. I've seen him line up in a game versus Ohio State, blue chippers, not a lot of experience that year. JT Tuimoloau, who's been whooping everybody else, and I see our Marius Mims go in there and win ugly. Okay, cool. Tyler Smith when he was in college. Boy, that's some ugly hands he got. Boy, them feet look funny. He doing a whole bunch of holding, but what we did see is Tyler block people off the film. We saw him do that. He saw him drive people, and we go, hey, man, if he fix one and two, at least he'll start winning pretty. My thing with Tyler Guyton, I don't even see him winning ugly. I see him out of control a little bit, not using his hands very much, kind of belly thumping into people.
Yep.
Throwing the chicken wing out there. Mm-hmm. Not great with his hands. If he's pass setting, don't get me wrong, his movement's incredible. His movement is incredible. As far as getting to the landmark, cutting the defender in half, he gets there perfect. Is he going to throw a strike? He may or may not. Is he going to catch you? He could. Is his palms going to be up so his hands in, you know, they end up on your back somewhere and he kind of ends up hugging you? 100%, right? So my whole thing, there are so many tackles in this class that's ready right now. Blake Fisher's ready right now. Jordan Morgan, who's a tackle, we'll talk about it later, he's ready right now. These dudes can play for you. Christian Jones, Texas, can play right this second. Man, you got to figure out Tyler Guyton. And you don't know how long you got to figure out Tyler Guyton. And if you're in the Cowboys, you're in the Super Bowl window. And, man, I might trust Austin Riches more than I trust Tyler Guyton right now. We feel funny about Austin because he hadn't played. But I remember watching Austin.
I don't feel funny about him. I like him. I'm bring him on. Let's see what he did on the offseason.
I totally agree. I mean, Austin's college tape was better than Tyler Guyton's college tape. It's just that I don't want to choose the player that's a dream. Hey, if we do X, Y, and Z, he'll be here. Yeah. I at least want to see you win. So long story short, I like Tyler, but I want him to be somebody else's problem. And if he goes to Duke Manny Weathers College for outstanding, get you better offensive lineman academy, then cool. I just don't know for sure. And there are so many dudes that can play for me right now that are better than him.
I'm just going to read real quick my last note on my Tyler Guyton report real quick as we were hearing him. I worry that his issues are not just that he is a raw prospect. He has played 1,000-plus snaps at offensive tackle in college football while Amarius Mims has played like 800, but that he also just needs to pay better attention to details. This is my issue with Tyler Guyton, is that we've been labeling this guy as this upside, this guy, he just needs to kind of, you know, tighten the screws on this and this and that. Mm-hmm. Dude has played over 1,000 snaps in major college football program, and he still has these problems, right? You nailed it. Like, there are only a handful of human beings that are 6'7", 322 pounds that have the mirror athleticism that he has. And those are incredible. In a vacuum, that's an incredible ball of clay to work with. But this is clay that's been worked over. Like, this is clay that someone has been working on it. And it's like, you know, rock hard solid. It can't be moved. And so I have concerns that, you know, we're all assuming you get this guy into an NFL program and, oh, all these problems go away. This guy's played a lot of football at a high level, and he still continues to have these kind of very basic issues. And you name them, right? It's attention to detail. It's is your hand placement correctly? I have yet to see Tyler Guyton reload and punch a second time appropriately. Like you'll see him appropriately get a punch in there once in a while, but if he ever has to reload his hands, he's missing. Like, it's just not happening. So I completely agree with Guyton, and I think where I'm really torn is that I think he has so much to his game that he could probably contribute in some way right now. But my question is, like, are you willing to put him out there as he is right now if there isn't necessarily a promise that he's going to get better? And I think that's the difference between me with him and Mims. To me, is that I feel very good that Mims is good enough now and will get better. I think Guyton is probably good enough right now. I don't know if he's necessarily going to get a ton better.
That's fair. And some people that may not, and I don't want to be this guy, man, but some people that may not know the nuances of offensive line, they'll be like, well, but why does this matter? Man, like, if you're having a hard time with the Iowa State kids, right?
Yeah.
The Eagles aren't going to play with you. No, you know what I'm saying? The Giants and their guys, they're not going to mess around with you. And what I noticed is that the harder the competition got for Tyler Guyton, the worse he looked. He has some solid games, and if you look at his highlight tapes, they're all against teams that you feel like that they could be beaten. But you know, Kansas, surprisingly cool little D-line, they gave him some problems. Texas, they're really physical over there, they gave him a gang of problems. Texas, yeah. Again, a gang of problems, you know what I mean? So yeah, I don't want to deal with that project. And if he's a project and he has this much to work on, I like Tyler Guyton, but he can't be my 24 pick. If I'm picking you at 24, I want to sleep good. I want to be like, all right, cool, man. All right, day two. Let's go get day two. If Tyler Guyton is my 24th overall pick, I'm hoping day two is much better. You know what I mean? So it's rough for me.
Voch, I got to ask you that. It leads me to this next question. Mm-hmm. If it's not Tyler Guyton at 24, the Cowboys are dead set on taking, let's say, a left tackle type. Mm-hmm. Who is the name for you? Like, who is the name that you hope the Cowboys draft at that spot?
So you talking about the next tier of guys, or just, hey, like well, Mims, I mean, is going now what?
Well, let's assume Mims is part of that conversation. I'm thinking like the Mims, Fuaga, Jordan Morgan, Patrick Paul, Kingsley, like all those names are available. Who's the guy that you want?
You ain't got.
I'm jumping up and down. If all those names are available, if Cowboys pick at 24, I'm like, wow.
Sir, you don't have to sell me on some damn Talisi Fuaga in Dallas or Troy Fautanu in Dallas, or, you know,
Amarius Mims. I don't need to be sold on Amarius Mims.
Are those guys tackles? Are left tackles though?
Those guys are, well, I was having a conversation with Duke Manyweather, and he said that our Marius Mims can play both tackles. So I'm going to believe the dude that works with him every day. Right. But you know, it just comes down to how do you win, and can I see you consistently win, and are you in control? And our Marius Mims, as funny looking as it looks sometimes, yeah. You know what I'm saying? And he got those long arms and he'll reset them long arms, but man, he wins. And he wins ugly. It's your job as a coach, as a private coach, as a Duke Manyweather, as a Mike Solari, to teach him how to win pretty. Hell yeah, you can talk me into some Mims. But if he's not there, we just talking about some day two guys. I'm not a Kingsley Suamateo guy because he kind of got the same issues that Guyton has. He's a rough around the edges guy. I love his athleticism. I do think he's farther along than Guyton, though. I don't see Kingsley throwing chicken wings and, you know, chest bumping into people,
as
right?
As a pass blocker, for sure. Like, he's
for sure.
I wonder if Guyton's a little further as a run blocker, though.
Guyton's heavier. So leaning on people probably helps him out a little bit. You know what I mean? But hey, what happens when the other side gets a little bigger? So that's the thing. But just, you know, tier two tackles, the only ones I trust, Blake Fisher, I trust him. Notre Dame, we could talk about Christian Jones, tackle from Texas. We can trust him. Both of those are right tackles, but they can play left. I believe they can. And we saw Christian Jones Senior Bowl. They definitely moved him all over the place. So I, and then Awesome Richards. Give me some Awesome Richards. Don't make me draft a guy just because we don't trust Awesome Richards. At least let him fight for his life. And if it don't work, then you'll play Chuma Doga and hope that he knows the plays.
All right. We're going to do some quick hitters on the offensive line, because I want to talk about where certain players, their best positions are at in the NFL. We will get to that next. This episode is brought to you by eBay Motors. Passion, drive, and patience. That's the formula for winning championships, and it's also what keeps your ride or die alive. eBay Motors has everything you need to maintain your vehicle and level it up to peak performance. Superchargers, roof racks, exhaust kits, LED headlights, and more. Whether you're into speed, power, or style, eBay Motors has got you covered. With over 122 million parts for your number one ride or die, you'll always find exactly what you're looking for, because with eBay Motors, you're burning rubber and not cash. With all the parts you need at the prices you want, it's easy to make your car the MVP and bring home huge wins. Keep your ride or die alive at ebaymotors.com. Eligible items only. Exclusions apply. eBay guaranteed fit only available to U.S. customers. Welcome back to the Locked On Cowboys podcast. We are here with Voch Lombardi to talk some offensive linemen. And Landon has put together a list of some players he wants to know where their best fits are at in the NFL. So, Landon, why don't you go ahead and start us off?
Can I ask something real quick? Can I ask
something? Please, go ahead.
So just one last thing that we can move over to. What do y'all think about Patrick Paul from Houston? Because I've been very critical of him, but you know,
but he's long. I mean, he holds a lot. But we're used to offensive linemen that hold a lot, so it's not a big deal, right?
Yeah. I just see some people, you know, talk about him as a day two option, man. I don't think Patrick Paul is all that good, man. Just humbly, respectfully, I don't think Patrick Paul is all that good. I just want to know where y'all were on that.
I was taking the time to pull up my notes again real quick. You know, I think I kind of viewed him as a like similarly graded player for me as Tyler Guyton. Mm-hmm. I actually probably liked Paul more than you did, liked Guyton less than the consensus, right? Yeah. So I view both of these guys as probably early day three picks, you know, late day two picks. Early day third round picks, late second round picks probably.
Okay. That makes sense to me. Yeah. When you're in Cowboy land, you see a bunch of mock drafts and they always put Patrick Paul in there. Like, hey man, if we don't get tackle, like these few guys, just don't draft me tackle. Let's just roll with Osmond.
Have you seen the Patrick Paul in the first round mocks? Because those have been out there the last few weeks. Yeah.
I've seen it, and it's total nonsense. I'm going home. I'm cutting off the TV if you get Patrick Paul at 24.
Yeah, but no, I think you're 100% right. And this is a good point, that there is a point in which, you know, you cross a Rubicon and it's like, is it worth it to continue to try to force tackle at a certain point? And I think that there is a point in which it doesn't quite make sense anymore. All right, let's go over a couple of guys that we feel like have position flex, and we kind of just wanted to get your take on where they might be, what their best position might be specifically for the Cowboys, you know, obviously since this is a Cowboys podcast. So first one we'll talk about is Troy Fatanu. Obviously this is a guy that everyone's talked about as potential swing guy. I think he was actually ended up being Dane's number one guard on the beast list. Do you feel like, you know, that there is a lot of potential, more potential at guard? Do you feel like he can be as equally adept at tackle? What are your thoughts there?
I think he's a special left tackle. I think he'd be a ridiculous center, but that's just me being an ex-center, just, you know, daydreaming or whatever. But man, his movement, his patience, he don't look all that big and tall on film or whatever, but if you look at the numbers, he kind of is. And boy, you just see him working the hands. You just see him setting up people, faking the hands. Come upfield, snatch technique, boom, on the ground, bam. You see him finishing people. You see him cutting the defense and cutting off the backside linebacker. You see him in space. The Polynesian kids this year, the Tonga and Samoa and all those guys, they just the super athletic, angry dude, you know what I mean? I'm just loving that so much. But Troy's one of those players. I looked at him kind of like we all looked at like Darnell Wright from last year. Oh yeah, he'll be here at 24, but I bet by the time we get to draft day, Troy will be gone like 10 or something, 12 or something like that. But I love Troy. Leave him at left tackle or play him at center for my center dreams, but nah.
Okay, the second guy I had is a guy we actually haven't talked very much about, but a guy that I liked a lot from TCU, tackle, guard, potentially, Brandon Coleman. What are your thoughts on you know, he's kind of sized like a guard a little bit, but I felt like his tape was good enough that he probably could play some tackle if he needed him to. What are your thoughts?
His 2022 tackle film wasn't all that great, but boy, I think he's another dude. This is the year for the big centers. You know what I mean? Take him and just let him snap the football. Let him be an athlete. I think he moves really well. I think just me, how I like my guards in particular, right? It depends if you run a zone, of course, too, right? You know, he's super athletic. I think he can make all the movement plays, right? But I want my guards to be able to dig those guys out of A gap. I want powerful dudes at guard. So I think his power, or just where he's at power wise, I think let him be a stronger center than to let him be like a super strong guard or whatever. I don't think he has super strong guard stuff, but I think he is powerful enough to be considered strong center guy. So let him be an athlete. Let him combo dudes. Let him cut off the backside linebackers. Let him pull if he needs to. I like him at center, but he can also play guard.
What about Talese Fuaga?
Oh, Talese Fuaga is a gangster, and he can line up and do whatever you want him to do. Yeah. Hey, man, watching him, one of the first plays that made me fall in love with any offensive lineman, can you block somebody off the film? And if you can block Leatu Latu off the film, I'm just going to just stand up and applaud Talese Fuaga. I don't know why he's on the Cowboys 30 visit list. He's going to have to get in some trouble. He's going to have to get in some trouble to fall to 24. But, hey, I think he can play left tackle. I think he's probably going to stay at right tackle because, you know, that's just what the league probably sees him as. But I was listening to this podcast with Brugler and Nate Tice, and they were saying, and they were saying, hey, teams probably see him as a guard. And I just don't think you should just put dudes at guard because their arms aren't all that long. Like, can you deal with the long defenders? That's really what matters to me. So just like you'll probably ask my Jordan, but if you can deal with the long arm defenders, I don't care what your arm length is, right? If you work in the elbows, if you grabbing wrists, if you're striking first, if you're feinting, if you're baiting guys like that, then cool, you're fine. Fuaga doesn't really do that. Fuaga deals with the long arm, the long arm ends with violence. You know what I'm saying? Like, if you put hands on, get your arm off of me, and then there's, you know, violence afoot. You know what I mean? So yeah, he could play guard. Yeah, I'll definitely like him at guard. If you got three tackles on your team, put him at guard, but leave him at right tackle. He's fine.
Yeah. I really liked him a lot, and I think he plays basically anywhere, and he's fine. This guy is really one of the ones that's going to be the big debate, I think, for a lot of these teams, and especially for Cowboys fans, and I don't know, for Marcus specifically. Jordan Morgan, where do you feel like his best spot is? And again, like, does it matter if it's like, I think it does matter based on what offensive line, you know, coach you have, what scheme you're running, especially run blocking scheme. Mm-hmm. Where do you feel like Jordan Morgan's best fit is in the NFL?
I love his athleticism. I love his pass protection work. I think he has a black belt and left tackle. I think he has fantastic knee bend. That's another thing I don't like about Tyler Guyton. He stands up straight up, and he's 6'7" already. Jordan Morgan has fantastic knee bend. Not a small dude at all. And yeah, if you are working some of these zone concepts, you need him to reach defensive ends for whatever reason. You need him to, you know, do, you know, long sideways blocks or whatever, or just lateral blocks, down block and reach block and whatever. Then yeah, he can do that for you, right? But I think that dude got a black belt and tackle. I think he has a black belt and tackle. So with Jordan Morgan, I at least want to see him try him at tackle first. Try him at tackle. And if he fails at tackle, then cool. Do the Connor Williams thing and put him at guard. And if that don't work, put him at center. You know what I mean? Do that whole thing. but just watching him versus competition, Trice gave him a hard time. But all the other competition that he's gone against, Jordan,
he was great against Latu Latu. Like, you watch, that's what's crazy is you watch the Latu stuff and he was unbelievable. It was Trice that gave him some problems. Mm-hmm. I don't understand the guard talk in Dallas with Jordan Morgan, because like, if you look at Mike McCarthy's history, go look at the two tackles he had in Brian Bulaga and David Bakhtiari. Like, those are both really athletic tackles with shorter arms, but they had great feet. They're great athletes, and they stayed in front of their defenders all the time. Like, he's a left tackle for me, and if I have to move it inside, that's fine. I'm going to get a quality player, but I wanted him to play tackle.
Yeah.
I also don't think it makes much sense in the Cowboys scheme to move him in as a guard. No. You know, like look at the Cowboys. As the years have gone on, they've run less outside zone. It's more inside zone, more man, more power stuff. Not a ton more, but they're definitely moving towards an inside zone versus an outside zone scheme, right? And I think you want kind of some bigger bodies up front to kind of, like we talked about earlier, protecting the pocket, physically moving folks off the ball. And I think that's not necessarily what you're getting out of Jordan Morgan if you're moving him into guard. That's not like the benefit of a Jordan Morgan. The benefit of a Jordan Morgan is how incredibly athletic he is. And mm-hmm. I think that's where you get benefit playing him at tackle a little bit if you need to. And especially if you're going to want to pull him across formations, that sort of thing, he can definitely do that. But he could still also do the backside cutoffs as the three techniques if you need him in wide zone. You know, all that stuff that is required of a tackle. I like him a lot in guard schemes for, like, you know, a wide zone system, you know, more of a Shanahan base. I mean, but even Shanahan's not running as much wide zone. Mm-hmm. So, I think there's nothing on his tape to me that says that he can't play left tackle. You know, it's all based on measurements that we're basing the fact that he can't do it. So last guy, Dominic Pony, was a guy I really liked watching. And I think he honestly could play probably all five spots. What do you think, and where do you think his best spot is?
He's another guy that I think is left tackle slash center for me. You know what I mean? Give him the football, let him snap, and just let him be athletic. But you know, if I thought he was with the Cowboys already, but apparently that's his cousin or his nephew or his
it's his brother, I believe.
Okay, cool. There's another puny. I was like, man, didn't we just do this?
Yes.
But Dominic is a totally different dude. But watching his film, man, you know, sneakily, I love his athleticism and, you know, these athletic Kansas tackles, just like Bosic last year. You kind of profile him a little bit. Okay, he ain't all that strong. Let me see what's going on. And he's got just enough power to make me like him a little bit. So, you know, he's another guy that's maybe like a day two guy for me. Round, he might be one of them late threes for somebody, mm-hmm. maybe an early four. Like if wide receiver going a real good run, he may fall down to four maybe. But just watching him, love him moving backwards, love him pulling, love him reaching, like all those athletic lateral blocks, I love those from him. But I think in the Senior Bowl, I believe he was working out as a guard sometimes mm-hmm. too. I mm-hmm. like my guards to be powerful. I want my guards to line up and whoop people and just dig people out of A-gap. That ain't necessarily him for me. But tackling center, I would love to see him there, but leave him at tackle. I think he's good right there.
All right, that is it for today's show. We want to thank you for making Locked On Cowboys your first listen every single day. Go check out the channel on YouTube. We post videos every single day over there. We are free and available on all platforms. We want to thank Voch Lombardi for jumping on the show. He's going to be back this summer. He doesn't know this yet, but he's going to be back this summer. Talking Cowboys, getting you guys ready for training camp.
Go follow him.
Yeah, get the three. Follow him on Twitter at Voch Lombardi. Go follow Lennon on Twitter at McCoolBCB. I'm at Marcus_Mosier, and we will see you right back here tomorrow.